Hello, everybody, and a very good morning to one and all. It's my great privilege to welcome you one and all for this webinar on the new posture in cybersecurity in the network world. To start this webinar, I welcome you one and all, and to start this webinar, we'll have a word of prayer. I invite Professor P. Benita, professor from CEC Department, Francis Xavier Engineering College, for invoke the prayer.
Pray. Dear loving Heavenly Father, thank you for giving one more day in our life. Before the start of this webinar, we are all gathered in your mighty feet for your blessings and support. Lord, enrich our resource person with your knowledge so that he can use his potentials fully. Lord, we are also praying for our participants. Help them to make use of this time effectively. Lord, we are also praying for the people who are working hard for the success of this program. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Almighty, I thank our management of Francis Xavier Engineering College for giving this opportunity to conduct this webinar. I thank the chairman of Francis Xavier Engineering College and also our managing director for all the support and for the motivation and for all the initiative in conducting this webinar. Also, it's my immense pleasure to welcome Dr. K. Jayakumar, the general manager for development, for giving the support, the initiative, and the motive for conducting this webinar. Also, it's my immense pleasure to welcome Dr. Velmurugan, the principal of Francis Xavier Engineering College. It's my immense pleasure to welcome and thank Professor P. Brinda, the HOD of CEC Department, for all her support and for all her motivation and all for all her initiative in conducting this webinar in a grand manner. Also, it's my immense pleasure to welcome Dr. Parvinder Singh, the resource person of this webinar from Chandigarh Engineering College, Mohali, Punjab. I welcome you, sir, to this August gathering. Also, it's my immense pleasure to welcome all my colleagues and comrades of Computer Science and Engineering Department. And also, last but not the least, it's my immense pleasure to welcome the participants of this webinar who are participating in this webinar. I wish and pray that you get a lot of insights and knowledge and motivation from this webinar. With these words of welcome, it's my immense pleasure to welcome my close friend and my comrade and my friend, the resource person of this webinar, Dr. Parminder Singh. To introduce about him, Dr. Parminder Singh is a young, dynamic personality with a proven record of good academician and researcher, having an outstanding academic record. He has been working as associated professor in information technology department in the Chandigarh Engineering College, and he has more than 14 years of experience in the area of teaching and also in the area of research. He has published more than 70 journals and 70 papers in journals and also in conference. He holds two patents in the area of networking, in the area of wireless networks, sensor computing, and also in network security. And he has completed 3 projects, including DST projects. And he has conducted several webinars in the area of network programming and software-defined networks with Cisco systems. And one of the remarkable achievement of Dr. Parminder Singh is he has won the best paper award from IEEE in the year 2012 and 2014. He has received the Young Teacher Award in International Conference in ICIC 2018. And he has also received the Faculty Excellence Research Award in the year 2011, 2013, 2015, 2016, 17, and 18, and 19. And it's a great credit for him, I think. And we are so proud to have this eminent personality in midst of us. I thank Dr. Parminder Singh for accepting our invitation and consenting to be the resource person for this webinar. Now I welcome Dr. Parminder Singh, the eminent person, to take over the session. Over to Dr.
Yes, sir. Okay. So today my topic is a new posture for cybersecurity in network world. So first of all, I am thankful to Dr. Arvind Swamy and Francis Xavier Engineering College who gave me a opportunity to deliver a talk on cybersecurity. I'm also thankful to my organization and Cisco Networking Academy who always support me. Right now, the topic of my presentation is the new posture for cybersecurity in network world. According to recent surveys, experts consider cybersecurity to be in a top priority. That's true even of industries like banking and automotive, where there are huge risks that have appeared in recent years. Today, every company, financial firm, are target of cyber attacks and risk managers now consider cyber risk to be the biggest threat to their business. So the danger is too large and current posture may not always be successful. Cyber risk may arrive in new way as company and industries hold new technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, and Internet of Things to gain more profit. So therefore, there is a much more awareness towards cyber security. So the agenda of my topic is cybersecurity. Cybersecurity should be comprehensive, adaptable, collaborative in a real world. Thereafter that, we can discuss the cyberspace, which includes digital network and network as activities which is associated with the cyberspace. Tools like Wireshark and TCP dump, which can analyze the traffic on network system, which comes under the understanding of tools. With the help of these tools, we will show you the HTTP and HTTPS protocols. We compare these protocols to better understand. Finally, we explain the conclusion and the reference section. Now, coming to the what is cyber? So cyber is not just the internet, which means it is not just internet, it is relating to information technology, virtual reality, and computers. Cyber used in a growing number of terms to describe a new things possible to a heterogeneous system. So heterogeneous system are different system which includes PC, your routers, and switches together. They are used for providing a communication. So the network system connected to the internet, or it may be a standalone system. The standalone system is also risky if the malware is installed on the system. When the infected system put into the real world or connected to the other system, then it might be dangerous for the organizations. So the motivation of attacking networks can be financial, state-sponsored, or malicious standalone system, which spread the malware to the connecting device. So the malware which can be inserted into the standalone system, which can separate the malware to the connected system, which can be deployed on the particular network. So the number of groups which involve in attacks, which might be state-sponsored or individual to access the system or spread malware. So these attackers are also called as threat actors. This one. So these are threat actors. So next one is cybersecurity. So when we can talk about the cybersecurity. Earlier, we can also define the cybersecurity should be comprehensive, it is adaptable, and collaborative in a real world. This is the basic definition of a cybersecurity. Basically, it can give a protection to a network system, data, or unauthorized use or harmful information. So it can protection of a cyberspace. So when we can talk about a cybersecurity professionalist, they should recognize the threat. They can recognize the malware. They can recognize the malware that poses if it is used against the people. So there are two terms. One is threat and vulnerability. Threat and vulnerability. So threat and vulnerability are the main concern in the world of cyber. The threat is an harmful event that seeks to damage the data, steal data, or disrupt any digital information. Cyber threats are viruses, or these are also a denial of services attacks, whereas vulnerability is the weakness of the system or which can be exploited by the threat actor. So for example, if the attacker to perform unauthorized activity in the system, so a cybersecurity professionalist can identify, can analyze the type of a malware, type of a threat, or they can identify and they can isolate those attacks. So these are the main responsibility of a cybersecurity professionalist. So if we can take another example, like data which can be delivered to the wrong hand, so can result in a loss of privacy for the owners, can affect their credit, their career, or they can affect the personal relationship. So identity of theft is a big business. So organizations like Google, Facebook have the resources to hire top cybersecurity professionals to protect their domains. Now coming to the protection, which we will include the conventional concepts like CIA, that is a confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So confidentiality, only the authorized individual person who can access sensitive information. So in a confidential, we can encrypt the data. When we can send the data from one station to the another, thereafter that we can encrypt the data so that unauthorized user can never access that information. This is the concept of a confidentiality. So this means that there are two stations, S1 and S2. S1 sends data to the S2. So the data which can be delivered to the S2 means it can be in an encrypted form. That's called as confidentiality. Second one is integrity. Integrity means when a station 1 sends data to the station 2, so that data which cannot be modified, or which is not be altered, that is called as integrity. Availability. So these are the authorized users who can access the information, resources, or data. So this term is called as availability. I think you can learn about the confidential, integrity, and availability of the system. So these three parameters which can be used in a cybersecurity world. So the motivation behind the cybersecurity is that the government, businesses, and individual users are increasing the target cyber attacks and experts, so they can predict the attacks which are likely to increase in the future. So thereafter that, there are number of attacks which can be increasing day by day. So thereafter that, we can lot much awareness about these type of attacks. We can analyze the number of attacks so that we can protect our own system. Even a cybersecurity education is a top priority or top profile, high profile cybersecurity, which can which can be used to overcome the cybersecurity risk. Thereafter that, there are many courses which can be launched by Cisco, like a CCNA Cyber Ops, CCNA Cyber Ops Operations. So the students can gain a knowledge towards the cybersecurity of courses, so that they can analyze the threat, they can analyze the vulnerability, or they can mitigate those malware or those threats. Next one is cyberspace. Cyberspace is of many forms, and the personal information which goes around the digital world. In fact, it is also seen that the nation states hacking other countries or snooping with internal politics. All activities come under the network system because the content and information which is available in the network. So in my general point of view, that we can make a stronger network system which could be tamper-proof, which cannot be accessible, which can remain a tamper-proof. So on the other hand, if we on the other side, we can say the major concern is the loss of trust that comes when a company is unable to protect their personal data. So in a cyber space, we can the data which can move in the digital world, we can protect all the data. So next one is types of attackers. Before explaining the attackers, we can talk about the cyber criminals. So cyber criminals are attackers who attempt to exploit vulnerability for personal or financial gain. Cyber criminals are interested in everything like a credit card, personal information and more, and much more. As we know that cyber criminals are attackers, and the attackers can be classified as a amateur, one is hackers, and another one is organized attackers. So amateurs are the script kiddies. These are which having a little or no skill. They often use some type of existing tools or instruction which can be found on the internet to launch the attack. So some attackers, like, they can try to demonstrate their skills. So they maybe use the basic information and they can spread the malware from the one system or one to many systems. So if they can launch the attacks, so the results become very shocking. On the other hand, when we can talk about the hackers, so these are the group of criminals which can break into the computer or network to gain access from various reasons. So the hackers can be classified into a white hat, black hat, gray hat hackers. So the white hat hackers break into the network or a computer system to discover the weakness in order to improve the security of the system. So the owner of the system, like any Google or Facebook, the owner of the system, which can give a permission to perform the break-in, and they will receive the result to test it. So basically, they can always, the owners of the system, they can hire the white hat hackers, or they can give a handsome money to the white hat hackers so that they can basically to identify the weakness of the system. So this organization can get a lot of information related to the vulnerability or related to the weakness of the system. Next, we can go through the black hat hackers. Thereafter, we can come to the gray hat hackers. So black hat hackers, they can take the advantage of any vulnerability for illegal personal, financial or political gain. They can spread the attack without any permission. So these are very dangerous. On the other hand, gray hat hackers are somewhere in between, we can say it is somewhere in between white and black hat hackers. The gray hat hackers may find a vulnerability and report it to the owner of the system. If the action accord with their agenda, some gray hat hackers publish the facts, like they can publish the facts about the vulnerability on the internet so that other attackers may know about the vulnerability of the system and they can exploit the system. They can exploit the user system. Therefore, it is very dangerous. Somewhat, it is very dangerous. Now, next we can talk about the organized hackers. So these criminals include organizational cyber criminal, terrorists, state-sponsored attackers. So cyber criminals are usually a group of professional criminals which can focus on control, power, and wealth. The criminals are highly, highly classy and organized, and may even, they can provide cyber crime as a service. So, like hacktivists make political statement to create awareness to issues that are important to them. Similar in a state-sponsored attackers, gather intelligence or commit disruption of any information in the network. So these attackers, like even we can say it about amateur hackers or organized hackers. So these attackers are very well qualified very well trained or very well funded. I'm only talking about the organized hackers, when we can compare to the hackers or amateur hackers. So organized hackers are very well trained, very well funded. So their attack focus on specific goal that are beneficial to the government. So some state-sponsored attacks are even member of their nation, or we can say these are armed forces. These are cyber armed forces. Next, we can talk about the internal security threats or external security threats. We can make a map of our organization, of any organization, we said. The internal users such as employee or contract partner intentionally mishandle the confidential data or using which means say infected USB pen drive into the corporate net corporate system. So this infected USB media infect the number of system or block the entire network. Internal threats have the potential to cause great damage than external threats, because internal users have directly access to the building or its infrastructure devices. Another important point which is kept in my mind, that the internal attackers typically have the knowledge of the corporate network, its resources and its confidential data. They may also have a knowledge of security policies and higher level of administrative privileges. And the next, we can talk about the external security threat. So external security threat, or we can say it can used by the skilled attackers, which can exploit the vulnerabilities in the network devices or can use social engineering to gain access of the network. So external attacks exploit the weaknesses of the system, weaknesses of the network, or vulnerabilities to gain access to internal resources. Now we are using some tools to get information and analyze the attacks. Through these tools, we understand the functionality of the HTTP and HTTPS protocol. Here, I can demonstrate most probably one thing is HTTP and HTTPS protocol. Here, HTTP is a hypertext protocol, and HTTPS is a hypertext transfer protocol secure, which makes a security to the user on the web interface. So for understanding of these tools, I have to use Cisco CyberOps workstation as a virtual machine. Inside the virtual machine, we are using a number of tools. So basically we can use a TCP dump, and second one is we can use a Wireshark. So before going to a practical, we first of all understand what is the use of a TCP dump command, and second one is we can understand the concept of a Wireshark. So next one is TCP dump command. So TCP is a command line interface to capture and display network packets. So if anyone can interested to download to use TCP dump tool, they can use a they can refer to the website www.tcpdump.org. So TCP dump is a non-GUI based tool which can be created by a Jackson team. It is used in a Berkeley software distribution Unix, and it is available in many systems. So it can examine the individual packets or communication sequences. So TCP, which can include a large number of Unix based distribution and can be installed easily in the operating system with a different package manager. In the next, we can talk about what is the file format of a TCP dump. So basically, it can capture the packet. It can capture the real-time packets. So they can use a PCAF format. All the information which can be captured by the TCP dump can store in a .pcap file. So basically, the PCAF file, which can mostly use the header file that is given below. This is a hash include PCAP slash PCAP dot PCAP dot h. So TCP dump mainly capture the file from the computer system interface. I will show you the interface in the demonstration. Through this interface, we can capture the packet. The packet which will be captured with the help of two functions, which can be shown, that is pcap underscore create, one function, and second function is pcap underscore activate. So these two functions, which can be used by the dot pcap file format. So following TCP dump option, which can be shown in this table, which can be helped to analyze the packet activity. So there is a first option is a minus h, which can print the TCP dump, which can print the message. Thereafter, minus c option, which can set the number of packets which will be captured. D is used to capture the traffic on the interface. I is the interface, basically I, which can be used to set the interface, to analyze the traffic on the user panel. Similar, if we can show the port number, we can use a minus NN option. Thereafter that, if we set in a particular network, we can analyze the IP addresses. Or we can identify our IP address, or we can identify the destination IP address. So thereafter that, we can use a minus N option. To save the particular file, we can use a W option. And after save the information, you can read the same information, which can be stored in a PCAP file format. You can use a TCP dump file. Like in the TCP dump, I can give you some information how to use the options. Like, first of all, you can use a TCP dump command. Thereafter that, you can use a minus I. I is the interface. So I also give a demonstration about the interface. So such like if there is some type of interface name. So here, the option which can be used in this, and there is a interface name. Suppose you can particular write the information. So you can use a TCP dump command. Minus I is the option. Minus W is the write option. Here you can put the interface name, and thereafter you can use a minus W option, and thereafter that you can apply a particular file name. Where it can store all the information in a .pcap file. So you can insert the name of the file. Suppose I'm given a name, w1.pcap file. So the all information can be saved in with the help of a TCP dump command. Now, we will explain the file format where the TCP dump follows. So we can here we can explain the two transport layer protocols. One is TCP and second one is UDP. With the help of these protocols, we will be identifying the packets, because these protocols are mostly used on the internet. So TCP dump print out a description of the content of packets on a network interface. So source and destination are the source and destination IP addresses. These are source IP address, this is source port number. Similar, this is a destination IP address and this is a destination port number. Here, you can use a layer 3 protocol, which can be either is a IP or ICMP protocol. Timestamp, when you can start the packet capturing. This is the time of the packet capturing packet. Thereafter that, with the combination of these four things, This is called as socket. Here, TCP, with the help of a TCP command, you can identify the socket. In a socket, there is a combination of source IP address and source port number, where there is a combination of a destination IP address and destination port number. There are also, we are using different TCP flags. So basically, there are different TCP flags, like one is push flag, one is RST flag, one is synchronous flag, one is acknowledgement flag, thereafter that one is urgent flag. So there are many type of flags which can be which is available, and TCP dump command, or with the help of a TCP, we can identify which type of flag can be executing during the transmissions. So basically, these are also used to analyze the behavior of the attack. Thereafter that, we can use a TCP sequence number. Suppose S1 can send a packet to the S2. They can send 5 packets, or suppose they can send 3 packets. So they can insert a particular sequence number. So S1 can send a packet to the S2. At the S2, suppose it can receive a packet number 2. Thereafter that, it can receive a packet number 3, and thereafter that, it can receive a packet number 1. So thereafter that, TCP can reorder the packets according to the TCP sequence number. So they can arrange like a 1, 2, and 3. Next one, TCP acknowledgement. When you can send a packet to the S2, you also get an acknowledgement of each and every packet. So that's why we can use a TCP acknowledgement number. TCP window size. So TCP window size belong to the buffer size of the window. So this is the buffer size of the window, or this is the buffer size of the destination machine. Suppose S1 can send a packet to the S2. So S2 only capture or only store 3 packets at a time. So S2 can give a window size to the S1. Thereafter that, S1 can set 3 packets and can send S2 at a particular T1 time. So suppose S1 can send 6 packets at a time, but the S2 only store 3 packets at a time. Thereafter that, S1 can send 3 packets at a time T1. Thereafter that, rest of all packets, like the totals, we can deliver 6 packets. So 3 first time, we can deliver first three packets at the T1 time, and thereafter the rest of packets we can deliver to the T2 time. So I think you can learn about our TCP window size. The data length, which can be used for a TCP payload length. I think TCP is done. Now we can start the UDP question. In the UDP, there is a timestamp, layer 3 protocol. Timestamp means you can capture the packet. Thereafter, at layer 3, which we can analyze the IP, ICMP protocols, because these protocols can be worked on a network layer. Similar, there is a socket portion. We can already describe you in the earlier. Thereafter that, we can discuss the layer 4 protocol. Layer 4 is a transport layer protocol which can use to identify the port number of the particular system. And thereafter that, there is a data length. So data length refers to the payload length. So in a UDP protocol, because UDP protocol, we can never use a TCP acknowledgement concept or TCP sequence number concept, because it is a connectionless services. Therefore, we can only using these terms. In the next, we can talk about the Wireshark. So Wireshark is a network analyzer tool for analyzing wired or wireless traffic. So if you, anyone which can be interested to the Wireshark, you can refer to the particular website at www.wireshark.org. There you can get a lot of information related to the particular tool. So in this tool, we can identify the performance problem, we can locate the security breaches, we can analyze the application behavior, and we can perform the capacity building. We can analyze bandwidth, we can analyze the quality of services issues, we can analyze the delay, we can analyze the latency issues. Similar way, we can also analyze the malware, we can also analyze the communication behavior. So this tool, which can capture the different traffic, can be work on a wired as well as wireless networks. So it is particularly, first of all, it is particularly GUI based tool. So in the earlier, we can study that TCP dump is a non-GUI interface. So in the Wireshark, which can provide a totally a GUI interface like your window. Meantime, the Wireshark perform on a wireless network. So in a wireless network, the behavior of a wireless network can work on a layer 2. We can examine the layer 2 protocol specifically for the wireless portion. If you can identify only a wired network, thereafter you can only analyze the behavior at a network layer, that is a layer 3 protocol. Meantime, there are different libcap libraries which can identify the link layer interfaces. Similar, when we can identify the particular port number, especially we can identify the Windows port number, therefore we can use a winpcap file. Airpcap is another file, or it is another library which is used in a link layer. It is only to capture IEEE 802.11 traffic. IEEE 802.11 traffic, which can only examine wireless traffic. So I think I can give you explanation of a TCP dump or Wireshark. Now let's we can demonstrate the particular this tool in the context of HTTP and HTTPS protocol. So we can identify the two protocols. One is HTTP. So we can also examine the vulnerability of HTTP. And thereafter, we can identify how HTTPS is more secure than HTTP protocols. Therefore, we can use two type of tools. One is TCP dump and another one is Wireshark. Now I just share the screen of my virtual machine. Here I'm just open the terminal. In this terminal, if you particular identify the IP address of your system, you can use IP config command. With the help of if config command, which can be used in a Windows operating system, if config command, which can be used in a Linux operating system. The particular IP address of my system is 10.0.2.15, and the corresponding subnet mask is 255.255.255.0. Here, the interface, that is the interface of my system, is ENP0S3. Here we can analyze the packets. We can analyze the packets. That is very important thing. So to analyze the packets, to identify the packet, to capture the live packets, you can always identify the interface of your PC. Now I'm using a command, TCP dump command. So I just clear the screen with the help of a control L, which can be used to clear the screen. Now I'm using a sudo. This is a particular authority. They can ask me a password after that. So now I'm using the tool, that is a TCP dump. Earlier I also said that TCP dump is a non-GUI based interface. Then minus I refers to the interface. So my interface is a ENP0S3. Here you already seen in a if config command. Thereafter that, I'm using the S for snapshot. So it can specify the length of a snapshot of each packet. Means it can identify the length of the packet. Thereafter that, you can mention the particular length. So I am starting from a zero length. They can identify from a zero bit to the number of bits. Minus W is the write operation. Now I can save all the information. So I am using a W command. Thereafter that, I am capturing the first of all HTTP packets. So I am using a, I am giving a particular name of the file, that is HTTP dump dot. Now they can identify PCAP file format. So the extension which can be used in a TCP dump can be a PCAP. And this PCAP file can also be identified by a Wireshark. We can all see all the things with the help of a TCP and with the help of a Wireshark. Here, sudo can ask me a password. I'm just give the password. Now, they can listening on my interface, that is your ENP0S3. So it can work on a link type. That is, it can work on a link type, means it can work on a Ethernet. Basically, it can work on a wired networks. Right now, I'm just give a particular dummy website name, that is altomutual.com. This is a dummy website. Here I'm just giving a password, a username. I'm just giving enter the username and password of the system, that is admin. Here we can open the particular website. Here the user can enter the particular website. Here this is a particular page, and this is a particular page which can never use a HTTPS. This is basically work on a HTTP protocol. Now the TCP dump command can analyze all the traffic. To save the file, we can use a control C. Now we can store 370 packets which can be received by the TCP dump, and this file can be stored in the format of a HTTP dump dot PCAP file. Now I can open the file, that is HTTP dump command, where the packet can be captured by a TCP dump. Right now this is a HTTP dump PCAP file. Now I can identify the particular packets. So I am using a Wireshark tool. Just I am pressing the double click the file. They can open a particular file, that is a HTTP dump.pcap file. Here there are number of flags, synchronous flag, acknowledgement flag, HTTP flag. There are number of flags which can be captured by our tool. These are tools. All the information can store by this tool. Right now, this one. So when you can open a particular file, this one here, you can identify a particular file which is HTTP protocol which is not found. So here we can look all the contents in this manner. So I am just only interesting the information saved by the HTTP protocol. Here I am just entering the username and password which can be stored by this file. Here the attackers can identify particular file. So I am just using TCP dot port equals to 80. 80 which can be used by the particular HTTP protocol. Here there are two methods. One is post and another one is get. The post can store all the information related to username or related to the password. So I am just identifying the post method. Here the connection is okay. Here TCP segment arrive. These are the segment which can be arrive right now. Yes, this one. This is a post method. So this is a particular login page, and the version number is 1.1. The post method can store the login information. So when I can double click the particular field here, this is my system 10.0.2.15, which can communicate to the particular website. The website destination IP address is 65.61.137.117, and they are using a HTTP protocol, hypertext transfer protocol. Now, the information which can be stored in do login page, and here in the login page, the host name is altomutual.com. This is particular connection length. This is a particular field, HTTP form URL encoded. Here you can access the details like the user ID is admin, the password is admin. So that's why how the HTTP is a unsecure protocol. Thereafter that, I know most probably in a many banking websites we can also see that they can use a HTTPS, because HTTPS is a more secure than a HTTP pages, because in the HTTP they can store each and every information. They can store in the each and every information in the form of a HTML format. So we can capture this type of information in this way. Right now, and just stop the particular particular website and just sign off. Now, if I am entering cisco.com. Here, what type of information which can be saved? That is a HTTPS website. So in this type of website, they can secure your protocol. The all information which can be stored by the post method is a in a way of a encrypted way. They can all information stored in an encrypted manner. So if you are using particular this way, I'm just stop all the things. I'm just open the terminal. Similar way, sudo tcp dump minus I enp 0. Here I'm change the file name, that is tcp dump dot pcap. Right now I'm just open the file name, that is cisco.com. okay, just enter password of my system, and right now I'm just enter the information. Just log into my log into the credential of the system. So suppose I am just entering particular information. I am just stop the sharing because I put the some credential of my just a few minutes. I'm just entering the username. The screen is not visible right now because of security purpose. And thereafter that, and put the password. Now I'm just share my screen. Now I input all the credential and thereafter that I'm just stop the just save the file. That's it. Right now the whole information can be captured by the HTTPS dump command. I'm close the terminal. And thereafter that I am close the this terminal. Now I am looking the HTTPS dump command. Here in the HTTP dump command, basically in HTTPS we can use a port number 443. So particularly when we can put a TCP dot port, because TCP HTTP follow the TCP rule. Thereafter that's why I am using a TCP dot port. And HTTPS always work on a port number 443. So I am just entering the 443 port number. In a 443 port number, here this is a transport layer security protocol. When you can capture the data, so this one, this is application data which can be stored by the wireshark or TCP dump. They can store all the information. Here, transport layer security, which uses secure socket layer. When I click the secure socket layer, in the secure socket layer, this is application data protocol, which can use a HTTP version 2 protocol. Here, the information which can be shown earlier in the case of HTTP, they can give a information like they can give a credential of the system. Right now, I can receive the whole information in a encrypted manner. So that's why HTTPS is a more secure than a HTTP protocol. Here, I'm given demonstration of HTTP and HTTPS protocol. Here, you can get that the information, the whole information, the entire information, which can be captured by the HTTPS is a whole, truly, it is an encrypted way. So the whole information, which can be encrypted way with the help of a secure socket layer. So transmission control protocol, they can use a source port number that is 35636. This is my system, and the destination port number is 443. And thereafter we can also get interesting information like there is a sequence number, acknowledgement length of the packet, which already we can study in the slides. So I'm just stop the share the PPT right now. Thereafter that we can right now we can learn the TCP, we can learn the Wireshark tool, and at last the conclusion part In this section, we can understand the concept of a cybersecurity and cyberspace. We can also understand the type of attackers, existing vulnerability in the system. We also understand the various tools. We can also demonstrate the various tools with the help of a cyber ops workstation. So we can also make a lot of learns between a clear difference between HTTP and HTTPS protocol. So I think in the last, I am using following references. Which you can also follow these references, which can also help in the future. So at that time, I'm just stop the sharing and thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. That's end of from my session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the very informative and useful session. It's my pleasure to take this opportunity to present the vote of thanks. First of all, I thank our almighty God for helping us in conducting this webinar. Then I thank the eminent resource person, Dr. Parminder Singh, for spending his valuable time in sharing his knowledge with us. Next, I thank all the participants for their presence. Last but not the least, I thank our management, our HOD ma'am, Professor Brinda, and all the people, those who are involved in this, in the successful conduct of this webinar. Once again, I thank you all. Thank you.